Welcome to ETSU Department of Psychiatry's Grand Rounds. I'm introducing Dr. Joseph Williams today. He's currently a clinical assistant professor in the Department of Psychiatry at University of North Carolina School of Medicine and also serves as medical director for the UNC Addictions Detoxification Unit. Dr. Williams received his medical degree from the University of Kentucky College of Medicine. He completed his psychiatry residency training with the Wake Forest University School of Medicine and his forensic psychiatry fellowship training with UNC School of Medicine. Dr. Williams is board certified in both psychiatry and forensic psychiatry. He has presented original research at national psychiatry conferences and has published manuscripts on topics related to general psychiatry as well as correctional psychiatry in peer-reviewed journals. Dr. Williams.
Can everybody hear me okay? Well, good morning, everyone, and thank you for inviting me to speak at your grand rounds. I will be presenting on a topic that is of increasing relevance to the field of psychiatry, namely correctional psychiatry. Let me just put this out. And before I go any further, just want to offer a couple of quick disclaimers that you guys can read. And there will be three parts to this presentation. The first part is a general overview of corrections and incarceration. The second is information about mental health within correctional systems. And the third is the psychiatrist within the correctional setting. Certainly, it is very important to understand the role of corrections and incarceration before you can really have a true appreciation for how the psychiatrist operates within the correctional setting. So the first part of this talk, we will really focus about corrections and incarceration. Before going any further, I just want to take a step back from correctional psychiatry and define forensic psychiatry, since the field of correctional psychiatry is actually, it falls under the umbrella of forensic psychiatry. So forensic psychiatry is the branch of psychiatry that deals with issues arising in the interface between psychiatry and the law. Also, the term corrections is something that I think everybody has heard of, and there may be some misunderstanding about what that term really means, so I wanted to offer a definition before we go any further. Corrections includes those agencies and programs at the local, state, and federal level that interface with individuals who have either been accused of crimes or convicted of crimes. Before diving into correctional psychiatry, I want to spend some time reviewing corrections and incarceration. So to provide some historical context, the modern system of correctional psychiatry or correctional incarceration began in the late 18th century and the early 19th century. The emergence and development of both psychiatric institutions and correctional institutions in the US and Great Britain during the 19th century reflected a desire to control social deviance. And this was born out of the reformist movement. There are two different systems or schools of correctional reform. The first is the Pennsylvania system. The Pennsylvania system began in 1790. It utilized solitary confinement and total isolation as tools to force the inmate to reflect upon and repent on his criminal behavior. Inmates were forbidden from interacting with each other in this system. Also, it was initially implemented at the Walnut Street Jail and at the Eastern State Penitentiary, which are located in Philadelphia. Dorothea Dix, the noted social reformer, she was actually a proponent of this correctional system at one period of time. The second system of correctional reform is known as the New York system, also known as the Auburn system. It began in 1817, so a little bit after the Pennsylvania system. It utilized a regimen of daytime group labor and nighttime isolation as a means of effecting moral change in an inmate. So in this respect, it afforded the inmates actually a little bit more opportunity for interaction with other inmates than did the Pennsylvania system. This system was initially implemented at the Auburn State Prison located in New York. And certainly, if anybody has any questions at any time, feel free to interrupt. We have touched upon the issue of confinement or incarceration, which leads to the question, why confine people who have been convicted of a crime? The answer is punishment, and there are four theories of why individuals are punished. First is rehabilitation, to correct those traits that result in criminal behavior. The second is restraint and incapacitation, to prevent individuals from committing future criminal acts through detention. The third is retribution, to punish or harm those individuals who break the law. And the fourth is deterrence, to deter or prevent the commission of future criminal acts. Incarceration can occur in three different types of facilities in the U.S.: lockups, jails, and prisons. The first we will touch upon are lockups. So what are lockups? Lockups are temporary holding facilities that often constitute the initial entry phase of the criminal justice system. It is the most common type of correctional facility within the U.S. The average length of stay at a lockup is less than 48 hours, so the people are there for usually a very short period of time. And they are typically located in police stations, and about 30% of police departments actually operate at least one lockup. The next are jails. What are jails? Jails are locally and often county-operated correctional facilities that confine individuals both before and after adjudication. They are used to house pretrial detainees, so those would be folks who are charged with a crime and are awaiting their trial, persons convicted of a misdemeanor offense, and a misdemeanor offense is something that would carry with it the risk of incarceration for up to a year, parole and probation violators, and those found in contempt of court. About 30 to 40% of individuals who are incarcerated in the U.S. are actually held in local jails. And about 60% of those folks who are in jails are awaiting some kind of a court action. So the take-home message with that last point is that a majority of folks who are actually in jail are not people that are serving time for a sentence. They're actually awaiting an upcoming court disposition or a trial. The last type of facility would be a prison. So what are prisons? They are confinement facilities that house individuals who have been convicted of felony offenses. And a felony offense would be something that carries with it an incarceration term of a year or more. Although there are exceptions that certainly exist in a lot of different jurisdictions. There are things that are known as safekeeping orders, or individuals who are known as safekeepers. A safekeeper would be someone who would be typically a pretrial detainee awaiting their trial, who would normally be held at a jail, but for whatever reason, that person is unmanageable at that jail and would be sent to a prison on a safekeeping order in order to be better managed. So there could be several reasons for why that person would be sent. One would be that perhaps it's a high profile case, perhaps there is some threat to that person's life in that county or community where they live, and they feel like that person's interest and safety are better served, you know, being in a prison. Another issue is if the person has some acute medical or mental health issue that requires treatment that would be beyond the scope of what the jail would be able to provide. They would often then be transported to a prison, even though that they're not a sentenced inmate. Another issue is if the person is just so violent or dangerous that it's felt that they are just unmanageable by the staff at the jail, they could be sent to a prison for appropriate management. But typically, prisons are for folks who've been convicted of felonies. They are operated by both state and federal governments. About 60 to 70% of incarcerated individuals in the U.S. actually serve their time in a prison. And prisons are classified as either minimum, medium, or maximum security. And then this other phenomenon called supermax exists. And some of you folks may have heard of supermax. Supermax can either be freestanding prison facilities, or more often they're a wing or an arm of a maximum security prison that has additional security protections in place. And these would be for folks who are viewed by the prison as being a very high risk of becoming violent or aggressive within the prison setting, or folks who've acquired several infractions while they've been incarcerated. Typically, supermax, and often you'll hear this referred to as being in a security housing unit or a secured housing unit, an SHU or a SHU. These people are in solitary confinement. They're typically locked up for 23 hours a day. There's been a lot of discussion about the appropriateness of that kind of level of control and custody, but that's what a supermax facility is. Typically, they are parts of a maximum security prison, a wing that would be dedicated for these folks that are designated as being high violence potential or people who've had a lot of infractions within the prison system. So as I mentioned before, prisons are operated at both the state and the federal level. So here in Tennessee, you have the Tennessee Department of Correction, and they have a very nice website. I actually searched it about a week ago to see what the current data, the numbers were. And there are right now about 21,000 inmates who are housed within the Tennessee Department of Correction. And these inmates are housed in 14 state prisons. And I believe that maybe three of those prisons currently are run by a contract agency, and the rest are actually just state-run. At the federal level, you have the U.S. Federal Bureau of Prisons, and so this information would be up to date. There are about 193,000 inmates that are within the U.S. BOP. 157,000 of them are housed in 122 Federal Bureau of Prisons facilities around the country. 22,000 folks are actually housed in 13 privately run correctional institutions, although that will soon change. Within the last month, the Bureau of Prisons announced that they plan on phasing out the use of private correctional institutions within the federal system because of some concern that maybe there were more negative outcomes in with regard to issues where both staff and inmates were injured, control of violent acts, things like that, that these were more problematic in the private institutions than the federally run institutions. And so now there's going to be a movement to actually phase those out. Now, if you'll notice, these numbers don't add up. If you add 157,000 and 22,000, it does not equal 193,000. There are actually some folks that are considered to be Bureau of Prisons inmates who are not actually housed in a prison per se. They would be kept in something that would be similar to a halfway house in a community, but they're not in a facility of incarceration, so to speak, but they are considered inmates within the BOP. So that's why those numbers don't add up to 193,000. I have listed here some interesting statistics related to incarceration in the U.S. So from 1980 to 2008, the number of incarcerated persons in the U.S. has essentially quadrupled up to about 2.3 million, and that would be as of 2008, according to the Bureau of Justice Statistics. You guys may have heard of things called mandatory minimum sentencing requirements or the three strikes laws. These are things that really led to a significant increase in the number of folks who've been incarcerated in the U.S. over the last few decades. The U.S. leads the world in the number of individuals who are incarcerated. So it's a little bit less than 1% of the adult U.S. population that's incarcerated, according to the Bureau of Justice Statistics. Also, about 20 to 25%, so about a quarter of all of the world's prisoners are actually incarcerated here in the U.S. According to the United States Department of Justice, the average inmate cost who's housed in federal prison costs between $21,000 and $33,000 a year. The range is due to the fact that some inmates require quite a bit more, maybe medical or mental health treatment, things that would add to the expense. So they gave a range with the Department of Justice or the Bureau of Prisons website. According to the Tennessee Department of Correction, the average inmate here in this state costs about $27,000 a year. So this is certainly not cheap. Now that we have a basic understanding of corrections, we will shift our attention to correctional mental health and correctional psychiatry. Interestingly, the three largest psychiatric facilities, and by that I mean the numbers of psychiatric patients who are being housed in a facility in the U.S., are actually three detention centers. Cook County Jail, located in Chicago, it houses about 9,000 inmates, 30% of which suffer from a diagnosed psychiatric disorder. You have L.A. County Jail and Rikers Island Jail in New York. Deinstitutionalization, and I'll say something about that in a second, it has played a key role in the shifting of individuals with serious mental illness from the hospital to the correctional setting over the course of the last few decades. Here in Tennessee, so I searched the Tennessee Department of Mental Health and Substance Abuse Services website to gain some information about the largest state psychiatric hospital. And apparently it is Middle Tennessee Mental Health Institute, located in Nashville. And according to their site, they have 207 inpatient psychiatric beds available. The largest Tennessee state prison psychiatric hospital is in a facility called the Lois M. DeBerry Special Needs Facility, which is also located in Nashville. It has capacity for 370 inpatient psychiatric patients. Back to deinstitutionalization. You know, this is a process that began really in the 1960s as part of the Community Mental Health Act of 1963. At the time, and it's really existed within the context of the civil rights movement, there was a concern that a lot of the folks who were being essentially warehoused in state psychiatric hospitals around the country, that the conditions that they were living in were quite deplorable. They really had very little recourse for getting out of the hospital. At that time, there was really not a whole lot to offer in terms of evidence-based treatment. And so the thought was that these people really do deserve an opportunity to be out in the community. And so beginning in the 60s and really increasing quite a bit in the 1980s, there was a movement to shift a lot of those folks with serious mental illness from the inpatient setting to the community setting. And the thought behind this was that if some of the monies that were typically being set aside for inpatient treatment, if they were then diverted to being used for community support services and outpatient-based treatment, then those folks would be well-maintained in the community. I think the idea was very good. I think it ended up not working out the way that the legislators had planned who had passed that act, because really what happened is, for reasons that are certainly talked about and debated about and are beyond the scope certainly of this talk, the monies were either not available or were misappropriated or not used properly, and a lot of that money that was going to be set aside for community-based treatment didn't really materialize. This is a situation where a lot of people who suffered from severe mental illness were released to the community without much support in place. And not surprisingly, a lot of those folks then became homeless, and then quite a few of them over the last few decades then became involved in the criminal justice system and were then incarcerated for various reasons. So deinstitutionalization, it's kind of interesting. If you were to look at a graph looking at the reduction in psychiatric bed space availability, from the 1950s or 60s to now, it's like the inverse of the number of psychiatric beds that are being utilized in correctional centers. As one's going down, the other is going up. And in point of fact, according to the Treatment Advocacy Center, from 1950 until now, there has been an approximate 90 to 95% reduction in the available state psychiatric bed space in the country. And so there's really, these people have gone somewhere, and a lot of places that they've gone to are houses of correction. This slide really gets to the point of why correctional psychiatry is relevant to all practicing psychiatrists. Individuals with mental illness are often involved with the criminal justice system and are frequently subjected to criminal incarceration. So here are some statistics. So as of 2014, the Treatment Advocacy Center's study showed that there were 10 times the number of individuals with serious mental illness in jails or prisons than in state psychiatric facilities. Now, I will say that they looked at state psychiatric facilities. They did not consider private psychiatric facility beds, so that would have to be taken into consideration. About 40% of individuals who have been diagnosed with a serious mental illness have been incarcerated in either jail or prison at some point in their lives. And according to a study published in 2009, about 16% of jail and prison inmates possess a serious mental illness, which was defined, as you can see, as a DSM-IV-TR diagnosis of either schizophrenia, schizophreniform disorder, brief psychotic disorder, schizoaffective disorder, delusional disorder, bipolar disorder, or psychotic disorder not otherwise specified. Now compare that to what the number was from a study in 1983. At that time, it was 6.4%. So according to that research that was published, it went from 6.5% to about 16%. Looking at jails, and so I said prevalence of psychiatric disorders in jails / lockups. Really, this data is taken from jails. As we had mentioned earlier, lockups, the people are typically there for less than 48 hours. There's really not a lot of data that has been published, or really any data, really speaking to what the mental health condition is of the folks that transit through that system. But there certainly is quite a bit of data about the folks that go through jails. And so about 64% of jail detainees suffer from a mental health problem. Now, I will say that is a very loosely defined term. The Bureau of Justice Statistics, they were having a lot of these jails that they were involved in this study administering a kind of a mental health screen where folks were coming in. And so if a person had, you know, answered yes to any of the mental health screen questions, then that would qualify as having a, quote, mental health problem. So you can see it's about two-thirds of folks. Now, 6% of jail detainees possess what is thought to be a severe mental illness, which they defined as either a psychotic or an affective disorder, according to a study published in the mid-90s. The National Commission on Correctional Healthcare, they've estimated that in jails, about 1% of the folks incarcerated possess a psychotic disorder, 2 to 3% had experienced a manic episode within the preceding 6 months, and 8 to 15% had experienced a major depressive episode within the preceding 6 months. Now, looking at prisons, so that data was about looking at the prevalence of psychiatric disorder in disorders in jails. For prisons, the numbers are a little bit different. So 45 to 56%, so essentially 50% of prison inmates suffer from a mental health problem. And as I mentioned, that is a very loosely defined term, similar to what was used when they were looking at the folks in jail. Now, the next couple of bullet points, there's some discrepancy. The first bullet point was based on a study published in 1991, and it found that 5 to 10% of prison inmates possess a severe mental illness, which would be having a psychotic or an affective disorder. Interestingly, the APA in 2000 published data showing that 20% of prison inmates actually suffer from a serious mental illness. So that's perhaps double or twice the percent of what it was in 1991. Now, one thought about that is it could be that in that very short period of time, those 9 years, there was a substantial increase in the number of folks who are incarcerated in prisons who have serious mental illness. The other issue that's been brought up is that maybe there was an issue with one of those studies where perhaps one piece of data is actually not reflective of what the reality was. If it is, you know, if those data are to be believed, I mean, that's a substantial increase in a relatively short period of time. The National Commission on Correctional Healthcare, they've estimated that 2 to 4% of prison inmates possess a psychotic disorder, 2 to 4% suffer from bipolar disorder, and 13 to 18% suffer from major depressive disorder. Some information just related to briefly to substance use disorders. So according to a study published in 2000, looking at newly admitted inmates, about 60% of female inmates and about two-thirds of male inmates had reported consuming alcohol in the 3 months prior to their incarceration. And about 33% of those folks said that they had been drinking alcohol daily leading up to their intake. The same study found that over two-thirds of newly admitted inmates had reported using drugs other than nicotine or alcohol at some point during their life, and of those folks, 80% reported using drugs in the 3 months prior to admission. I want to briefly touch on two issues that are of special importance in both general psychiatry and certainly correctional psychiatry, and they are suicide and violence. So here's some information related to suicide. So suicide is the leading cause of death in jails, and it's the second leading cause of death in prisons, according to 2008 data from the Bureau of Justice Statistics. Just for a point of comparison and just to get an idea about the context, you know, and this is based on 2013 data. Actually, the CDC, I think, has released some updated data showing that the suicide rate has actually gone up a little bit nationally. But at that time, it was 12.6 per 100,000. I think now it's pretty much around 13 per 100,000. It is the 10th leading cause of death in the general population. So it's the 10th leading cause of death overall in the community. But in jails, it's the leading cause of death. And in prisons, it's the second leading cause of death. The rate of suicide in jails is felt to be quite a bit higher than it is in the community. So one study published in the mid-90s showed that the rate of suicide is 5 to 8 times higher than what it is in the community. Now, I will say that there is some controversy about that data. There is some thought that it is actually lower than what that would show, and that maybe there was a sampling bias. But as it stands, what is clear is that the rate of suicide in jails is definitely quite a bit higher than what it is in the community. Also, the rate of suicide in prisons, while not as high as it is in jails, is still elevated compared to what it is among within the general community. It's about 1.5 times greater. So here's some more information about suicide. Hanging is the most common method of completing suicide in correctional settings. You know, in the general community, it's suicide by gun, self-inflicted gunshot wound. A lot of research has looked at trying to identify the reasons for why folks who are incarcerated in either jails or prisons are more prone to successfully committing suicide than folks in the community. One study that was published in 2000 identified two, and they're pretty general, phenomena that they thought really were related to the increased rate. They described jail environments being conducive to suicidal behavior. Another was that the inmate is facing a crisis situation. So I think a lot of the thought behind this is that jails are often very chaotic environments. There's a lot of movement in terms of folks moving in and out. Often there are gaps or lapses in terms of the amount of monitoring that's being done of folks. Often folks that come into jails, unlike people that are admitted typically to prison who may have actually been incarcerated in a jail for several months leading up to their prison incarceration, they often come in intoxicated or under the influence of a substance, and that would raise the suicide risk. Also, the issue about a crisis situation, you can kind of view that as like an acute adjustment disorder issue almost, where the person is facing, you know, has really not had time to process maybe what has just happened in terms of their recent arrest and all of the sequelae that could follow from that. They may also be in a compromised position where maybe they're under the influence and are lacking some of their faculties, and the combination of that, you know, could create a situation where a person would be more prone to committing suicide. Correctional suicides typically occur relatively early in the course of incarceration. I included this bullet point because I think that there may be some myth that the people that would perhaps be more likely to commit suicide would be the classic patient could be a guy who's serving a life sentence, who's maybe 30 years into his sentence and is looking at 20 to 30 years more time before he dies of natural causes, and there's really no hope in sight, and he's kind of reached a breaking point where there's just nothing more and that maybe he would take his life. That's actually not borne out in the research. Typically, the suicides that happen earlier in the course of their admission, and I think it probably gets back to the second bullet point, the causes of jail suicides, that there's, typically a person is more prone to committing suicide at a time that is, relatively speaking, closer to the issue, the incident that led to his arrest and incarceration. So in terms of violence, there's an agency called the National Institute of Corrections, and they actually did some studies looking at trying to identify factors that were predictive of violent behavior in prison. And they actually then worked in conjunction with the National Commission on Correctional Healthcare to come up with some risk factors. And so you can see at the top part are factors that actually have been found to be predictive of violent behavior in prison. So younger age, male sex, recent history of violence, mental illness history, gang membership, and recent disciplinary action within the correctional setting. Factors, interestingly, that have been found to be not predictive of violent behavior in prison, according to this group, drug and alcohol abuse or use, that was kind of surprising, history of escape from prison or jail, sentence length, severity of their criminal offense, and time left to serve. Those were not found to be predictive of whether a person was going to be violent in prison. Interestingly, there are some important legal requirements for the care and treatment of folks who are in a correctional setting. So this is something that is very different than the rights that would be generally afforded someone who is not incarcerated. So there are two constitutional amendments that actually provide protections for incarcerated individuals within the U.S., the 8th Amendment and the 14th Amendment of the Constitution. The 8th Amendment of the Constitution protects convicted inmates from suffering cruel and unusual punishment. Now that's for folks who are sentenced inmates. The idea is once you are sentenced, then you are punished by incarceration. So it's, if something is happening during the course of your punishment that is felt to be improper or, especially severe, then that could potentially constitute cruel and unusual punishment. Well, but for folks who are housed in either jails or as safekeepers, like I mentioned, in prisons, often they are pre-trial. They've actually not been sentenced. They've not been convicted of a crime. They're being housed there while they're awaiting trial, but technically the law has not said that they have yet actually done something wrong. And so those folks, when they're housed in correctional environments, the concern was maybe they would not be entitled to the same standard of care in terms of protection as a sentenced inmate would have, because again, a sentenced inmate is protected by the Eighth Amendment. Well, the federal courts have said that folks who are pretrial detainees actually are afforded the same kind of legal protections for care and treatment as are sentenced inmates who are incarcerated based upon what's called the Due Process Clause of the 14th Amendment. And the 14th Amendment is an amendment that addresses citizenship rights and equal protection under the law. And the thought about this was that someone who's not yet been even convicted of a crime should be entitled to at least the same level of protection as a similar person who's actually been convicted of a crime. So that's why whether you're in a house of incarceration awaiting a trial or whether you've been sentenced and are serving your punishment, you are entitled to constitutional protections for how you are treated. Well, the reason that this has some relevance to medical and mental health treatment is that individuals, and these individuals could be prison administration officials or jail administration, they could be nurses, they could be physicians or psychiatrists that work within the correctional environment, those individuals can be subjected to civil litigation or civil action pursuant to something called Title 42 of the U.S. Code, Section 1983. And this is something that allows folks it allows for a lot of different things, but the thing of relevance would be if someone is incarcerated and they are their constitutional rights are being violated, they have recourse to seeking that to be addressed in federal court. And so there have actually been some landmark court cases about medical and even mental health treatment and what kinds of rights inmates have regarding access to that treatment who are incarcerated. The first court case I mentioned is probably the most notable, Estelle v. Gamble, and this was actually a U.S. Supreme Court case. Mr. Gamble was an individual. He was serving a sentence in the Texas Department of Correction, and he had injured his back at some point and had chronic back pain. So he had put in multiple requests to be evaluated and treated for his back pain. And he was seen on multiple occasions by different providers within the Texas Department of Correction. So these would have been prison physicians. And he was offered different treatments. And apparently he was not happy with the treatment that was offered. And he thought it was below the standard of what he would be entitled to. So he actually filed a civil suit in federal court under Title 42 of the U.S. Code, Section 1983. And he alleged that by depriving him of competent medical care, that constituted cruel and unusual punishment, that he was not able to go out in the community and seek treatment on his own because he was incarcerated by the state. And he felt like, you know, that the prison environment down in Texas was not affording him any opportunity to seek competent and to receive competent medical care. Well, in their hearing and decision with this court case, the U.S. Supreme Court set the standard for what would have to be met in order for an inmate to actually be able to successfully sue prison individuals, like a prison administrator or a prison provider, under that section 1983. And the standard is referred to as the deliberate indifference standard. And this is a phrase, it almost kind of sounds oxymoronic, you know, how can you be deliberately indifferent? But deliberate indifference is something that was a bit controversial when it came out, and actually the U.S. Supreme Court in a later hearing had to kind of further define what it meant by that, and that's what the second case. So the first is Estelle v. Gamble. The second is Farmer v. Brennan. That's actually the one that provided some further definition for what deliberate indifference is. But deliberate indifference, I mean, it's a very complicated issue that's really, I think, beyond the scope of this, but the take-home point is that what my final bullet point says. A prison official would be felt to, and this could include a psychiatrist or a medical doctor, they would fall below the deliberate indifference standard if that individual possessed substantial knowledge that there was some risk to the person and did not act to prevent harm. So in the case of Mr. Gamble, he had this back injury. He was seeking treatment. You know, the back injury was, in his opinion, quite severe. if the Texas Department of Correction, if those folks that were working with Mr. Gamble, if they were aware that he had a back injury and they were aware that there could be some serious consequences from an untreated back injury, like maybe he would lose some ability to perform some of his activities of daily living, or that he'd be in such an amount of pain that his quality of life would be diminished, and that they did not act on that, then those prison administration officials or those prison officials could be held liable because they would have fallen below the deliberate indifference standard. Well, in point of fact, in the case of Mr. Gamble, Mr. Campbell was actually not successful in his endeavor. The U.S. Supreme Court found ample evidence that he had been seen, I think it was something like maybe 17 different times for that, and he was offered different treatments. He was not happy with the treatments offered, but they were felt to be generally appropriate treatments. And so they felt like that the Texas Department of Correction did not fall below the deliberate indifference standard. Now, Mr. Gamble, his issue was a medical or a physical issue. It was back pain. The question then would be, does this have any relevance for access to mental health treatment? Do inmates have some right to mental health treatment? And so this court case, Bowring v. Mills, actually shows that they do. Now, this was not a Supreme Court case. This was a U.S. Fourth Circuit Court of Appeals case. But in their decision, they held that there is no underlying distinction between the right to medical care for physical ills, that would be like Mr. Gamble, and its psychological or psychiatric counterpart. So the take-home message of all this is, you know, in terms of Estelle v. Gamble, that issued the standard, that was landmark in that it showed that people who suffer from medical issues or disabilities do have some right to some level of care, and that if folks don't seek that care, don't address those care needs, they can be held liable if they fall below that standard we just talked about. And similarly, folks who have mental health issues that are not being properly addressed, the people who are involved in their care or their incarceration, so that could be prison or jail officials, it can even be, like I said, psychiatrists, nurses, they can also be liable infringing on a person's constitutional right. So the take-home message, sentenced inmates and pretrial detainees have a constitutional right to medical and mental health treatment services. There is a lot of talk, especially, you know, with some of the political discussion that's been going on lately, about the issue of right to treatment. You know, there are some people that feel like there ought to be a nationwide right for people to receive medical or mental health treatment. Interestingly, as of right now, the U.S. Supreme Court has only designated one group of individuals who have a constitutional right to seek treatment services, and that would be people who are incarcerated. The thought behind that is if the state, and by the state I mean either the individual state or the federal government, but if the state is going to take the responsibility of confining a person against his will, and that person is not eligible to go out in the community and seek services on his own, then they are obligated to look after his medical, and then by extension from Bowring v. Mills, his mental health treatment needs. So it's kind of interesting that this is a group of people, and there have been a lot of important legal cases that really deal with appropriate medical and mental health treatment within correctional settings, because those folks, they have access to federal courts, whereas someone who just wanted to sue for malpractice, thought their doctor, you know, offered an inappropriate treatment, they don't have that level of recourse. I mean, they can file a civil tort, but they don't have access to the federal courts saying that their constitutional rights have been violated. Here's another court case of note. So this was not a U.S. Supreme Court case, but a U.S. Fifth Circuit Court of Appeals case, Ruiz v. Estelle. And Estelle, you notice the name is the same for that Estelle v. Gamble. Estelle was actually the guy that was the chief administrator for the Texas Department of Correction, and he was apparently a pretty busy guy in the 70s and 80s because he was involved, he was named in a lot of lawsuits. So a lot of lawsuits have Estelle in the name. But this holding showed that a system of correctional mental health care should be comprised of six components, and I've outlined them here. A program of screening and evaluation. So this is for mental health services. Treatment which goes beyond the mere segregation and monitoring of mentally ill inmates. Trained mental health staff in sufficient numbers to identify and provide individualized treatment. Complete, accurate, and confidential treatment records. prescribing and administering medications by qualified staff which is consistent with professional standards, and a method for identifying, treating, and supervising those with suicidal tendencies. The last one is important because I think the court in this decision realized that there was a special risk, a significant risk of suicide in this population, and they wanted to make sure that that was being addressed. The National Commission on Correctional Healthcare, in its standards for mental health services in jails and prisons, they've identified three basic rights for inmates: the right to access care, the right to the care that is ordered by a healthcare professional, and the right to professional medical judgment. And this would be for medical and mental health care. So, where can one look to gain an understanding of what the relevant practice guidelines are for practicing mental health in a correctional environment? Well, there are several sources, and I've actually listed four very well-known sources here: the National Commission on Correctional Healthcare, the American Public Health Association, the American Psychiatric Association, and the American Correctional Association. They all have published guidelines and standards for the care and treatment of folks who are incarcerated. The last part is a discussion about the role of the psychiatrist in the correctional setting. So now that we have some basic idea about what correctional environments look like and what they entail, and we have some basic idea about what it is in terms of like the scope of mental health issues within prisons and jails, we can talk about the role of the psychiatrist. So I want to highlight some of the insights based on my personal experiences. So I, as a forensic psychiatrist, I've worked in federal prison at the Federal Medical Center located in Butner, North Carolina. So that's a Bureau of Prisons facility, and it's a psychiatric hospital. I've worked both inpatient and outpatient services with the North Carolina Department of Public Safety, and I currently provide services with them along with my work at UNC. And the Department of Public Safety is your equivalent of the Department of Correction. And so I wanted to share some of my insights about what I've noticed, and specifically to highlight some of the potential obstacles that are faced by a psychiatrist who works in the correctional environment that may be a little bit different than perhaps, you know, although some of them, you know, would apply to people that practice in the community. So jails and prisons are noisy environments. And may I have a show of hands? Who all in this room is a psychiatrist or a psychiatry resident? And how many of you folks have worked in some capacity or been in a correctional environment? So if you've been into a jail, certainly jails, in my opinion, more than prisons, they are very noisy environments. There a lot of clanging. It's quite overwhelming at times in terms of how loud the scenario is. It's very different than what you would maybe be used to working in just a standard clinic. There are practical limitations to privacy and access to patients. The next one is really a big one. The primary responsibility of a correctional environment is custody, not treatment. So we work in a medical model as psychiatrists and treatment providers. We're used to typically being, you know, at the lead of a treatment team that would set forth a plan of care for a patient. So we really do have quite a bit of latitude about what we say and how that patient's going to be treated and receive care. In a correctional environment, it's very different. The purpose of a prison or a jail is not to provide mental health or you know, psychiatric services, although it is a requirement like we talked about. But that's not the sole reason for why they exist. We would be an ancillary function there. And so often what we may want to have happen, it would be trumped by maybe what custody or the administration would have to say in terms of their ability to move inmates around to be seen and still maintain the safety of the facility. Jails and prisons, they often have limited medication formularies. So this would be both for cost-saving purposes, also because prisons and jails really typically, especially prisons, really do like to limit medications that are sedating or anxiolytic, because those medications, as people are probably aware, do have some abuse potential, and so they are often not available on the formularies. Inmates often have limited access to non-pharmacologic treatment modalities, such as psychotherapy. So again, if you're working in a prison environment, or maybe you're in a supermax facility where the people are locked up 23 hours a day, kind of hard to do a DBT group or, you know, have a group therapy situation in that scenario. So often, a lot of the while there certainly are therapists and clinicians that work in prisons and jails, often the primary treatment modality is pharmacologic for these folks. Some more. Correctional psychiatrists, they often have very large caseloads. There is, I would say, a very high attrition rate among correctional psychiatrists. You know, it's an environment that is a different kind of environment than what a lot of people are exposed to, either doing training or in their professional work experiences as a psychiatrist. And often they will go there, and maybe after a period of time, they'll get, I'd say, maybe burned out, or they will see that it's maybe not a good fit for them, and they'll leave. And then often, you know, there'll be a lot of turnover, and maybe just a few people that stay on, and often then they're having to carry a high caseload. Malingering, and you know, malingering of course occurs in many contexts, but in the correctional setting it's often seen, and there are some reasons for why an incarcerated individual may want to feign or exaggerate symptoms. Maybe he wants to be moved to a different prison or a different setting. Maybe he wants to be moved out to, some states have contracts where if they're needing mental health inpatient treatment, they actually go to a local hospital. They leave the prison system. And so they may just want to be out of the prison for a little while, or maybe they see that as an opportunity where they could potentially escape from prison. They may also want to feign mental health symptoms for the purposes of, if they're a pretrial detainee, they may want to try to be found that they're incapable to proceed with trial so that they would not have to stand trial. Or they may be trying to make a case that they are, that for their crime that they committed, that they should be found not guilty by reason of insanity. So there's some extra reasons for why someone who's incarcerated may be prone to malinger, you know, symptoms of mental illness. The inmate population is litigious, although that's less significant now than it was, because there's been some legislation passed actually putting up some roadblocks to inmates filing what we would consider to be frivolous lawsuits. The correctional psychiatrist may be expected to function as treating provider, forensic evaluator, or both. So in my previous work, when I worked with the Federal Medical Center, which was a federal psychiatric hospital, we had folks that were sent there for several months who there was some concern about whether they were competent to proceed with trial because of their mental illness. So we were expected to treat them and also to evaluate their competency to stand trial. And that we refer to that as dual agency, and different people have different thoughts about whether or not that's appropriate. But often correctional psychiatrists are asked to be put in that position. The last thing is the stigma associated with working in a correctional facility. There are a lot of folks, and you can say that it's unwarranted or it is warranted, but the truth of the matter is there are a lot of folks that look down on people that work in prisons and jails, especially in areas that would be maybe more high-end, like medicine and psychiatry. They may maybe wonder why it is that someone would want to work in that kind of a population if they could maybe work in a community hospital or an academic setting, or if they could work in a clinic. And so there are definitely, I can assure you, there is a stigma in the field associated with working in a correctional facility. And so that concludes my talk. I wanted to open up to any questions or comments that anybody has. One thing that I'll say is, Dr. Moore, he couldn't be here today, but someone with his staff, I think, had made arrangements to print out some copies of a references list for my talk. So I think that there are some copies of that. And certainly anybody who wants to, you know, if any further, you know, I'll be sure to give my email address out. Anybody can contact me. Yes.
Do you have any comments about the recent use of solitary confinement in correctional facilities, particularly with juveniles?
Yeah, well, I can't comment so much about juveniles. I don't interact with them. I can certainly comment about just it being used generally. It is something that has been, in my professional opinion, overutilized. There is no doubt about the negative impact that kind of confinement has on someone's mental health functioning and well-being. It is documented that folks that have had no prior history of mental illness often develop psychotic disorders when they are, you know, exposed to that level of confinement and restriction. People that do suffer from mental health issues and are put in that system, that situation, the data is clear that those people suffer an exacerbation of their mental health symptoms, and that's actually a risk for completed suicide in a prison. In the state that I work, North Carolina, the North Carolina Department of Public Safety has been called to account for a lot of this, and so very recently, within the last year, they have set up a plan to reduce by 50% the use of solitary confinement, not just for folks with mental illness, but inmates in general. Because really, it is something where a lot of evidence and data show that it is very, very damaging to a person's mental health. And also, there's the concern that, you know, a lot of times folks with mental illness they get put in supermax or restricted housing or solitary because they will, you know, accrue a lot of infractions. Well, the reason that a lot of times they're picking up these infractions is because they're often not doing well with their mental health. They may be psychotic or manic. They may not be real quick to follow directions or instruction. And so also in North Carolina, up until 2 months ago, a person who attempted suicide, that was actually considered an infraction. So if someone attempted to harm himself because he was severely depressed or psychotic, he would actually then be subject to disciplinary punishment for that. Now, that part has been remedied. But I can't really speak specifically about juveniles, although I don't see where it would be any different than the, you know, general population. But, I mean, there is a real movement away from that. And really, the Department of Justice is really looking at closely state prison systems that they feel are overutilizing that.
And I guess I'll offer this to the whole room. It is common practice in the state of Tennessee for juvenile detention centers to put pre-trial detainees, these are juveniles who are charged but have not been convicted of anything, in solitary confinement, not as a punitive measure, but simply as a routine condition of confinement. So, for example, here in Johnson City, in our juvenile detention center, juveniles are held in solitary cells 23 hours a day, and then they are let out for 1 hour of solitary TV watching or some other recreational activity. The United Nations has issued a report to a special rapporteur declaring that solitary confinement for juveniles should be categorically prohibited as a form of torture. So here's the question for clinicians. You're working for a facility that does this, and they ask you to go in and do mental health assessments on young people who are being held under these conditions. Are you, by doing so, becoming tacitly complicit with a human rights violation, a form of torture?
Yeah, I would open that up. I mean, that is a very good question, and one that maybe does not have an easy answer. I would open that up to what do people think about that? What if you guys, and I'm especially thinking of some of the residents in training, you know, a lot of residency programs are really trying to incorporate exposure into correctional settings as part of the training. What if you were asked to participate in that? What would be your thoughts about that? I mean, that is a very good point, and it's one that is difficult because, you know, from my standpoint, you got away, if everybody leaves the system, then they will not have access to treatment. But at the same time, if you're participating in the treatment, then maybe you're aiding and abetting it. And like I said, the group is, they're a fairly litigious population. And you know, you mentioned a UN mandate. You know, the U.S. Supreme Court has said that, you know, there's a prohibition, the Eighth Amendment prohibition against cruel and unusual punishment. And if you have organizations, defining solitary confinement as cruel and unusual punishment, that could create a precedent where then a U.S. court may agree. So I would kind of ask my junior colleagues, how would you guys handle that? And I don't mean to put you on the spot. Maybe, I mean, there is really, I don't know. Sir, what would be your thought about it? It's an excellent point.
When we're being asked to evaluate this patient, and I guess in the prison setting, are we evaluating their mental faculties? And we are going to be giving in our input, correct? As the practitioner on the case?
So it would depend upon what your defined role would be. So okay. In my role that I do, I'm an assistant professor with UNC School of Medicine in Chapel Hill. And we have, within the last year, developed a relationship with our equivalent of your Department of Correction because of a lot of issues where they've not had competent care. So several of our psychiatrists now working. So I provide outpatient-based services, medication management for adults within the prison system. So my role is strictly treatment. I am not involved any, it would be no different than, I mean, my goal would be no different than treatment that would be offered in a clinic. You know, that people have a mental illness, I would diagnose it and offer an approved treatment for it and monitor it. My job would not be to evaluate whether or not they would be criminally responsible for a prior criminal act or whether they are competent to stand trial. Now, in my previous work with the federal prison system, that's what I did. But so it really depends on, if you were going to work in a correctional setting, it would be very important that you would know clearly on the front end what your duty is, what your responsibility is, and if it's something that you are not comfortable with, then to not do that. The reason I no longer do competency evaluations, I actually thought that there was a significant ethical concern about the dual agency that I mentioned. So I'm just involved in treatment. And while I have an academic interest and have published in things like treatment to restore competency to stand trial, I do not, that's not something that I practice. Some of my colleagues feel differently, so it would be a decision that you would need to make. But I would strongly suggest to any of my colleagues here, if you're going to work within that system, to know what it is that you're going to be doing on the front end. If it's something that you're not comfortable with, then thanks, but no thanks.
I guess my take on it was that I would go as the practitioner and assess and then recommend my treatment plan, but also if I found the need for solitary confinement not necessary, make a strong mandate against it for that specific.
Yeah, and I can speak to North Carolina. They are now they're being forced to take into consideration the treatment team's recommendation more than they were before. It was strictly a custody matter. It was left up to the prison administration, and they were looking at policies and procedures. If you have a certain number of infractions and were put in disciplinary segregation, you're going to be in solitary, and you will be in it for a set amount of time. And I mean, they did not take into consideration previously mental health factors. Now, because of some pressure from the Department of Justice, a lot of states, the correctional systems, are having to take that into consideration, and the treatment team is actually able to weigh in and actually have some of that changed. Or those folks are diverted to residential type units so that there would be more flexibility in terms of their conditions of confinement.
Regarding HIV-infected individuals in the prison system, they would have a higher rate of psychiatric disorder and also hepatitis B and C infection. To what extent do you think that they get comparable treatment as they would outside of prison? And in addition, another related question is, it's known that upon release from incarceration, it's particularly a high likelihood period for HIV transmission and increased HIV risk behavior. To what extent is the prison system obligated to provide prevention interventions as patients are being released?
So it's a very interesting question. Two parts. The first part would be, I guess, maybe commenting about the ability of them to actually treat folks with either HIV or hepatitis C or B within the correctional setting. I mean, they are required to receive treatment. So in some way, a lot of those folks would not be able to afford the treatment for hepatitis C in North Carolina because of lack of insurance. But in the prison system, if they meet certain criteria, then they are obligated to have to offer that. So in that respect, there may be some benefit. In terms of what services they have to provide when they leave, that's a very interesting question and one that's been up for some debate. So there's actually some court cases about to what degree prisons have to provide for some kind of aftercare, for folks that are released. And as it stands right now, there's been no U.S. Supreme Court mandate that there have to be aftercare services put in place. Now, those correctional guidelines I talked about, those agencies that have put forth guidelines, they all, talk about the importance of that. In North Carolina, they are provided some form of short-term aftercare that quickly then expires, and then they're left to their own devices. The issue that we have is, I don't see that in prison. They really separate the medical treatment from the mental health. The thing I see a lot about is we've really tried to work to increase the use of Clozaril or clozapine for folks who have, treatment refractory schizophrenia, or also, who are chronic self-injurers. You cannot believe the amount of self-injury that occurs in a correctional environment compared to like what a community hospital would be. And Clozaril has been used some for that purpose. And so the concern we've had is if we have someone on that, how are they going to be able to continue getting their blood draws, all of the medical monitoring that goes along with that when they leave? And there's very little that can be done except for a very short period of time. Now, that would be the case in North Carolina. I'll say I'm not sure of what provision is done in Tennessee. I suspect it's probably fairly limited, just because there's not a clearly a Supreme Court defined, you know, obligation for that. Because I think the thinking is, once you are released, then you are free to go and try to get treatment how you want. Now, that may not be reality-based, but I think they're looking at it technically. You're no longer locked up. So you bring up a great point, and I mentioned it briefly. So the Department of Justice and the Bureau of Prisons, which is under the Department of Justice, they are planning on phasing out those few federal facilities that are actually run by contract agencies. The report that it came out was quite damning. I mean, it really showed that there were a lot worse outcomes going on for similar types of prisoners who are being held at a privately run federal facility compared to a federally run facility. And so I think that is the real reason that they have decided to phase that out. Now, the correctional, the private facilities, they claim that the populations actually were a bit different and that they were in the position of having to deal with people that were more acute or more difficultly managed. I think that's open for debate. I think that's probably questionable. But the end result is that they have now set up a plan of action where they're going to have to phase out those remaining. In North Carolina, there are no state prisons that are run by a federal by a contract agency, but there are a lot of services provided in the facility that are run by contract agencies. In Tennessee, I believe, according to the Tennessee Department of Correction website, it was either 3 or 4 state prisons are run by a private firm, and I saw nothing mentioned when I was doing my, researching and preparing for this about whether there's any plan to change that. So I think it's like, there's 14 state prisons, 11 of them are run by the state, and I think the remaining three are run by a contract agency. But I've never set foot in a facility that's been run by a contract agency, so this is all based upon media reports similar to what you've read. Yes.
Prisons or whatever have a right to care when you're providing it as an outpatient equivalent to others. But the formulary, as I remember when I was working at least in jails or whatever, it's very restrictive.
Absolutely.
So in some ways, we're not really able to provide equivalent care. Now, of course, we can generalize that to say insurance companies also don't exactly give equal care, in their formularies. But it is quite restrictive.
Yeah, and that was one of the things I listed as a potential obstacle. You're right. It is very, I had some previous experiences working in inpatient treatment within the prison system and then got out of that and then came back recently when, like I said, UNC has developed this relationship. Some of my colleagues, this is their first time working in a prison system, and they were really shocked at what was not available in terms of medication use. Now, the prison systems, I would offer what I said in my disclaimer. My views do not represent necessarily, the North Carolina Department of Public Safety or the BOP or UNC School of Medicine. What I will say is that the prison administration, when we have meetings with them and to discuss expanding the formulary, what they will say, and they are technically correct, is they will say that about any psychiatric medicine is actually available within the state prison, but it has to go through a utilization review. So, for instance, Seroquel is a restricted medicine. And so I could put in a request, a utilization review or UR request, that my patient, he has failed X number of trials of other antipsychotics, or, he has significant TD, and this is a medicine that he's actually done well with in the past, and when his schizophrenia has not been treated well, he is aggressive, there's real negative outcomes. And so that will be reviewed by someone, and very, very rarely is it approved. So they would argue, well, about every medicine is available, but you have to meet the criteria. I'm still trying to figure out really what it is, the criteria that the folks that make the decisions in the administration are looking at, because they're not public, I don't know. But and the practice of it is, there are a lot of medications that you guys can easily prescribe for folks, and appropriately prescribe, that folks who are in a state prison would not have access to.
When you say outpatients, do you see them in the prison or do they come to your office?
No. So by outpatient, I mean they're not needing to be in the inpatient psychiatric hospital. So they are folks who are receiving mental health medicines, but they're in the general population of a prison. And so that's kind of a funny term. They're all ultimately inpatient, but these are not folks that are requiring a hospital level of care. So, you know, they get appointment slips and they would come to the office and they would see me and they would have similar things for their medical appointments. Then, you know, we have an electronic record system. I mean, all that would be very similar. So it's essentially like it's an outpatient clinic, but I mean, the folks don't go home after the appointment. They go back to their cell. Thank you.
One question. One thing I didn't hear about is that the sort of number one evidence-based predictor of violence in prisons is psychopathy.
Oh, yeah. Uh-huh.
Which is a personality measure and right in the ballpark of forensic psychiatry.
Yeah, uh-huh.
What do you think about the psychiatrist's role in the measurement assessment of psychopathy within the correctional setting?
It's a very good question. So there are actually, you know, actuarial tools that are used to actually measure the level of psychopathy. As a treatment provider, I'm actually not involved in that, but I was involved in that when we were looking at folks in terms of appropriateness for discharge to the community when they had been found either, you know, incapable to stand trial and whether they were then, you know, needing to be subject to a civil commitment or whether they could be released or people found not guilty by reason of insanity. We use that strictly in the federal prison as a tool, as one of the tools to look at whether or not the person was appropriate from a violent standpoint for discharge to the community. What I will say, it's not used by me or my colleagues in terms of a risk assessment within the prison system.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Yeah, and that's what we use at the Bureau of Prisons. Yeah. And it's interesting, you know, California, their prison system, it's actually under quite a bit of federal regulation and control right now. They've actually adopted a lot of the policies, I think, of what the BOP, the Bureau of Prisons, does in terms of their assessment, their risk assessment. But I can say, I can't speak for Tennessee, but I can say in North Carolina, it's not routinely, it's not used. Yes. And I'll say that I don't know how much time we have in this room. I mean, I don't want to hold some other group up. I'm happy. I will stay here as long as you guys would like me to.
I just wanted to ask if you had any comments on the Cook County model that's being implemented in the jail system there, and then any international models that you see, because they seem to be a lot less restrictive in kind of the European models.
So you'd actually have to you'd have to fill me out. What is the current Cook County model?
I think they were trying to expand kind of admissions to and expansion of mental health integration within the jail systems there. It was announced, I think, within New York Times had an article about it.
Yeah, I would say the only thing I can comment about that, because I really don't know specifically about that environment, and I've actually had very limited work experience in a jail setting as opposed to a prison, but there is been a lot of emphasis recently on looking at the quality of the care and services provided in correctional systems. And so I think that a lot of different facilities are looking at making changes to try to better accommodate the needs and to not be as draconian maybe as what has typically been the standard model of essentially, you know, if there's a guy and he's a problem, whether it's a mental health problem or just a problem, that he's gonna be put in lockup. Well, thank you guys. I appreciate you coming. And I think I've actually made an arrangement for us to have some pizza. And I think I maybe here.
That was great.
Oh, well, thank you. Thank you. Well, I enjoyed the opportunity.